Warm welcome to you to the Bruce Memorial Church as we gather together to worship God. Our call to worship today comes from Psalm 105. It's a psalm that gives thanks to God for keeping his covenant promises to Abraham to bless him and to make him into a great nation. And it also speaks about how he brought them out of Egypt and into the promised land. It's a wonderful picture of how God would later call out for himself a people from every tribe and nation, and redeem us in Christ, and bring us into the eternal kingdom of God. So let me read to you some verses from Psalm 105. Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him, and tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. He brought out Israel, laden with silver and gold, and from among their tribes no one faltered. Egypt was glad when they left, because dread of Israel had fallen on them. He spread out a cloud as a covering, and a fire to give light at night. They asked, and he brought them quail, and satisfied them with the bread of heaven. He opened the rock, and water gushed out. It flowed like a river in the desert. For he remembered his holy promise given to his servant Abraham. He brought out his people with rejoicing, his chosen ones with shouts of joy. So let us worship God together. Let's sing to his praise, O God of Bethel, by whose hand thy people still are fed. Let's pray together. God, we praise you for your grace and compassion. God, we bless you for your mercy and love. God, we thank you for your great faithfulness. Father, we confess that we deserve nothing at all from your hand. And yet you have chosen to shower us with blessings from heaven. You have lifted us up out of the mud and mire, and you have placed our feet upon the rock. And in Christ you have given us life, and life in abundance. God, we praise you for your grace and compassion. God, we bless you for your mercy and love. God, we thank you for your great faithfulness. Father, we confess that we often grumble and complain, and yet we have so much to be grateful for. And so we take time to thank you for our health and our strength and our daily food, and for our families and friends, and for our church and our community. God, we praise you for your grace and compassion. God, we bless you for your mercy and love. God, we thank you for your great faithfulness. Father, we confess that we are all sinners by nature and by practice. We are stubborn and self-centered, slow to obey your laws of love, and quick to fall into temptation. And yet you have chosen to forgive all our faults and failings. And you have given your own dear Son to take the punishment that our sins deserve. God, we praise you for your grace and compassion. God, we bless you for your mercy and love. God, we thank you for your great faithfulness. Father, we confess that we are often fearful and frightened, unsure of the right way to go, and anxious about the future. And yet you have promised to walk with us as we trust in you, to lead us and guide us, and to shine your light upon our path, and one day to bring us safely to our eternal home. God, we praise you for your grace and compassion. God, we bless you for your mercy and love. God, we thank you for your great faithfulness. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the most famous of Jesus' miracles was when he fed 5,000 people with just 5 loaves and 2 fish. All 4 of the gospel writers tell us about it, and in John's gospel you can read the story in John chapter 6. There was one boy who had 5 loaves and 2 fish, and there was Jesus, full of love and compassion. And before long, 5,000 hungry people were enjoying an eat-as-much-as-you-want buffet. And afterwards, there were 12 large baskets of leftovers. It was an amazing sign pointing to who Jesus really is, the Son of God himself. The Son of God who had come down from heaven and was doing things on earth that only God can do. I wonder if you can think of a story from the Old Testament when God miraculously provided food for his people. We mentioned it at the beginning of our service from Psalm 105, when the Israelites were spending those 40 years wandering in the wilderness. God provided food for them day in and day out, each day a fresh supply of manna, the bread of heaven. And it was that manna that sustained them for 40 years until at last they came into the promised land, that land flowing with milk and honey. And once they arrived there, the manna stopped because they didn't need it anymore. It wasn't long after Jesus fed that crowd of 5,000 people that he said this, "I am the bread of life." In fact, if you read through John chapter 6, you'll find Jesus says that several times in that chapter. John chapter 6 at verse 35, Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." And then just a little bit later in verse 48, he says again, "I am the bread of life. Your forefathers ate the manna in the desert, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever." So here is Jesus telling us that if we want to live forever, if we want to be part of the eternal family of God, then we must come to him and believe in him and eat for ourselves that bread of life that he offers, that he himself is. Each day of our lives, we must put our trust in him, just like the Israelites eating the manna in the desert day after day, trusting in God to provide for them, until at last, through Jesus, we come into the promised land, the city of God, the wonderful heavenly kingdom. So let's see how many of the I am sayings that we can remember that we've been thinking about over these last few weeks. Firstly, back in John 8, 58, "I tell you the truth," Jesus answered, "before Abraham was born, I am." In John 8, at verse 12, Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And then in John 15, at verse 5, Jesus said, "I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing." Then last week we were looking at John 10, verse 9. Jesus said, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved." And then today, John 6, verse 35. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me, will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Jesus is the one and only. He is the one and only Son of God. He is the one and only Savior of the world. And he is the one and only source of abundant and eternal life. So let's sing our next song. It's a new song to us. It's all about Jesus being the bread of life.
You are the bread of life. You are the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry. He who believes in me will never be thirsty. You are the bread of life. Jesus, you are the bread of life. You are the bread of life. You are the bread of life. comes to me will never go hungry. And he who believes in me will never be thirsty. You are the bread of life, Jesus. You are the bread. This is my body that was broken. This is my blood that was shed for you. Take it and eat and drink it. Remember me. You are the bread of life. You are the bread. Comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. You are the bread of life, Jesus. You are the bread of life. You are the bread of life. You are the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry. And he who believes in me will never be thirsty. You are the bread. Jesus, you are the bread of life.
Today's reading is from Luke's Gospel, chapter 17, and reading from verse 20. Once having been asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, Jesus replied, "The kingdom of God does not come with your careful observation, nor will people say, 'Here it is,' or 'There it is,' because the kingdom of God is within you." Then he said to his disciples, "The time is coming when you will long to see one of the days of the Son of Man, but you will not see it. Men will tell you, 'There he is,' or 'Here he is.' Do not go running after him. For the Son of Man in his day will be like the lightning, which flashes and lights up the sky from one end to the other. But first he must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation. Just as it was in the days of Noah, so also will it be in the days of the Son of Man. People were eating, drinking, marrying, and being given in marriage up to the day Noah entered the ark. Then the flood came and destroyed them all. It was the same in the days of Lot. People were eating and drinking, buying and selling, planting and building. But the day Lot left Sodom, fire and sulfur rained down from heaven and destroyed them all. It will be just like this on the day the Son of Man is revealed. On that day, no one who is on the roof of his house with his goods inside should go down to get them. Likewise, no one in the field should go back for anything. Remember Lot's wife. Whoever tries to keep his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life will preserve it. I tell you, on that night, two people will be in one bed. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding grain together. One will be taken and the other left." "Where, Lord?" they asked. He replied, "Where there is a dead body, there the vultures will gather."
Amen, and may God add his blessing to this reading from his holy word.
Loving God, speak to us now, we pray, and help us to hear and to respond to your word, for we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. December the 26th, 2004, began just like any other day. Many people across the world were on holiday, relaxing with their families and friends. But by the end of that day, more than 150,000 people were dead or missing, and millions more were homeless. Let me read to you part of an article from the National Geographic with the title, "The Deadliest Tsunami in History?" Giant forces that had been building up deep in the earth for hundreds of years were suddenly released, shaking the ground violently and unleashing a series of killer waves that spread across the Indian Ocean at the speed of a jet airliner. Within hours, the waves radiating from the earthquake zone slammed into the coastline of 11 countries, snatching people out to sea, drowning others in their homes or on beaches, and demolishing property all the way from Africa to Thailand. In some places, the tsunami announced itself in the form of a rapidly receding ocean. Survivors report that they'd never seen the sea withdraw such a distance, exposing seafloor never seen before. Tragically, the novelty of the sight stoked the curiosity of many people who ran out onto the exposed seafloor. Tourists in Thailand were seen wandering around photographing the scene. But those who knew geography knew what the receding ocean meant. In India, one man recalled watching a documentary all about tsunamis, and he remembered that when the ocean receded, it was a sign of real danger. So he sounded the alarm, and he led everyone in his village to high ground, saving the lives of 1,500 people. Experts say that a receding ocean may give people as much as 5 minutes' warning to escape to high ground. That might have been enough time for many of the people who were killed to have been saved, if only they had known what to do. Somehow the animals seemed to know what they were to do. They realized that disaster was imminent, and there were many reports of animals fleeing to high ground minutes before the tsunami arrived. When the ocean started to return, it was in the form of the tsunami, a series of crashing waves in some places, and in others a sudden flood that spread hundreds of meters inland. Some people couldn't run away fast enough, although many did manage to escape. Death struck randomly. People who were together when the tsunami struck were separated in the torrent. Some survived, others succumbed or disappeared. And in the midst of the devastation, a baby was found floating safely on a mattress. Everything I've said so far was from that National Geographic article about the tsunami. All through Luke's Gospel, we read about Jesus warning of judgment to come and appealing to people to come to him in order to be saved. He is a bit like that man in India, pointing to the receding ocean and warning that the tsunami is on the way and urging the villagers to escape with him to the high ground while there is still time. 2 weeks ago, we were reading from Luke chapter 12, Jesus warning the people to be ready for the day of his return, warning them about the dark cloud on the horizon, encouraging them to see the signs of the times and not to wait any longer, but to be reconciled to God. And last week, we were looking at Luke chapter 13, where Jesus urges people to make every effort to enter through the narrow door before that door is closed and they are left outside weeping and gnashing their teeth. We also saw last week in Luke 13 the great love of Jesus that motivated him to give these warnings to people. It wasn't because he was cruel that he was telling them about judgment to come. It was because of his great love. And that was the great love that compelled him not just to come and to warn people, but to go to Jerusalem and to go to the cross in order to die for them and for us. And we read last week about Jesus' heartfelt desire to save as many people as he possibly could. How often have I longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings in order to protect them. But you were not willing. In Luke chapter 15, you can read for yourself the three wonderful stories that Jesus tells there about the love of God for sinners, the lengths he goes to search for and to find and to redeem the lost people, and the great rejoicing that there is in heaven over every single sinner who repents and comes home. And it's in that context of Jesus' loving concern for sinners and his repeated warnings and invitations to run to him for salvation that we come to this passage before us in Luke 17 and to a similar passage that you can read later for yourselves in Luke chapter 21. In these passages, Jesus tells us what it will be like on that great and terrible day when the Son of Man is revealed, when the King of Glory comes with the clouds of heaven and in power and great glory. If you have your Bible open in front of you at Luke chapter 17, beginning at verse 20, you'll see that again it was a question from the Pharisees that prompted Jesus to speak about these things. So just picture the scene with me. A group of rabbis come up to Jesus. We're not told exactly where they are at the time. And they come, as it were, with their diaries in their hands, maybe their mobile phones open with their calendar app ready. And they say to Jesus, when is it that the kingdom of God will come? The premise of their question seems to be, if you really are the Christ, then please will you tell us what date it will be that the fire of heaven will burn down on the Roman Empire? When will it be that the kingdom of God comes and the throne of David is restored? And Jesus' reply, no doubt, left them confused and disappointed. He says to them, the kingdom of God does not come with your careful observation, nor will people say, here it is, or there it is, because the kingdom of God is within you, or perhaps among you, in your midst. The great irony of this moment is that the Pharisees are asking Jesus when the kingdom would come, but they are blind to the fact that the person they're speaking to is the king himself. They stubbornly refuse to recognize and receive Jesus as the Messiah. And they didn't understand that the kingdom of God comes gradually as people respond in faith to the good news and acknowledge Jesus as Savior, Lord, and King. I was hearing this week that in China there are millions of Christians, many of them secret disciples. If current trends continue, there will be more Christians in China by the year 2030 than there are in the United States of America. These Chinese Christians live in a country that declares God is dead, but they are worshipping the living God. Whatever the Chinese authorities may say, the kingdom of God is among them. Back in Luke 13, Jesus describes the kingdom of God as growing like a mustard seed. It starts very small, but grows into this great tree. It spreads like yeast through a batch of dough as people come one by one to Jesus and confess him as their Savior. Eventually, Jesus tells us people will come from the four corners of the earth, from east and west and north and south, and they will come and take their places at the great feast in the kingdom of God. And since Jesus made that prediction, we've seen it coming true. Over the last 2,000 years, the kingdom of God has been growing and spreading, slowly but surely, all around the world. The latest figures suggest that there are over 2 billion Christian people alive on planet Earth today. I wonder what the Pharisees in Luke 17 would have made of that statistic. There was so much that they didn't understand. They couldn't see that Jesus was the king. They didn't realize that he had come to lay down his life as a ransom for his people. They had no inkling that before long, in AD 70, the city of Jerusalem would be completely destroyed by Roman fire. And they couldn't begin to get their heads around the idea that the kingdom of God is a global kingdom. It's not just for the Israelites. It's for people from all around the world, for sinners from every nation who ask Jesus to be their Savior and worship him as their king. But once the Pharisees had gone, Jesus spent some time teaching his disciples about that day when he would come and claim his kingdom. He calls it the day of the Son of Man, or the day that the Son of Man is revealed. We know that the Son of Man is the title that Jesus preferred to use when he was describing himself. And it appears all through Luke's gospel. Just one example, back in Luke 9 at verse 22, Jesus tells his disciples, "The Son of Man must suffer many things, be rejected and killed, and then on the third day be raised to life." And at one level, this title, "The Son of Man," is a phrase that speaks about Jesus' humanity. Not only is he the Son of God, but he is the Son of Man. He is flesh and blood. He is one of us. And it also speaks of Jesus as our representative man, the champion of the human race, the second Adam, who to the fight and to the rescue came. But perhaps most significantly, the title, "The Son of Man," is a description of the Messiah. It comes, as I've told you before, from Daniel chapter 7. And in Daniel 7, Daniel has a great vision of heaven. He sees the Ancient of Days, a description of God himself. And in his vision, we read that he sees the Lord Jesus himself. Verse 13, "In my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days, the eternal God, his Father, and was led into his presence. And he was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. He was given an everlasting, unshakable, unbreakable kingdom. And listen to this, all peoples, nations, and men of every language worshipped him." And it may well be this moment from Daniel 7 that Jesus has in mind when he's speaking to his disciples in these words recorded in Luke 17. The moment when the Son of Man is revealed to the world in his true glory and majesty, the glory that the three disciples got a glimpse of on the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus is speaking about the moment that, in Paul's words, will be the time when every knee will bow before God's chosen King, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. The Pharisees come asking when the kingdom of God will come. But to use a buzz phrase of the moment, Jesus is far more concerned with data than with dates. He refuses to be drawn on exactly when all of these things will happen, the day of the Son of Man. But he gives the disciples some detail about what will happen. First, it will be unmistakable, unmissable when he comes. Secondly, it will be sudden. There will be no great warning. And thirdly, it will bring about a final and permanent separation between those who receive Jesus and those who will not. So look with me firstly at verses 22 to 25 of our passage. "The time is coming when you will long to see one of the days of the Son of Man, but you will not see it." There will be many, many dark days in the lives of the Christian church and individual Christian disciples. Days when they and we long to see Jesus come back. But Jesus says, "Don't be fooled if people say to you, 'Here he is,' or 'There he is.' Don't go running after them. And don't worry that you might miss him when he comes. For," verse 24, Jesus says, "the Son of Man in his day will be like the lightning which flashes and lights up the sky from one end to the other." Jesus is saying that his return, his coming, will be unmistakable, unmissable. Everyone will see it. It will be clear and obvious to everyone in the whole world that the King has come in his power and in his glory. Notice the contrast in verse 25. Jesus says, "First, I must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation." He knows that first he must endure the cross, 3 hours of total darkness, rejection, humiliation. But on that day, the day of the Son of Man, he will come like a bolt of lightning, brilliantly bright in his coming. And every knee will bow before him, including everyone who has rejected him down through history. They will be forced to acknowledge that he really is the Son of God, the King of glory. And then from verse 26 to 30, see how Jesus emphasizes that his return will be sudden. We've already thought of it being like a flash of lightning, which is incredibly sudden. Jesus says that it won't be with any further warning that he returns. He says that it will be a day just like any other day, just like the day when the flood came in the time of Noah, or when God sent judgment on Sodom and Gomorrah in the time of Lot, or like Boxing Day 2004 when the tsunami hit the countries around the Indian Ocean. People will be just getting on with life as usual on the day when he returns. They'll be eating and drinking, getting married. They'll be buying and selling, planting and building, working and sleeping. When all of a sudden, in the midst of that ordinary day, the Son of Man will suddenly be revealed like a flash of lightning as the King returns to claim his kingdom. And notice thirdly, how in that moment the whole world will be divided into two camps, those who belong to Jesus and are saved, and those who have refused to come to him and who are lost forever. Jesus speaks about Noah and his family. They heeded the warning that God gave them and they built the ark and they were saved. But when the flood came, everyone else, all the rebellious and unrepentant people of that day, were destroyed. Lot heeded the warning that God gave him, and he fled from the city of Sodom just before the fire and the sulfur rained down from heaven, destroying all the wicked and sinful people in that city. But Lot's wife, whose heart was still in Sodom, turned back and became a pillar of salt. And that's how it will be, Jesus says, when the Son of Man is revealed. All who have confessed him as their Savior and King will be brought safely through the final judgment of God. But those who haven't listened to his warning, those who haven't responded to his gracious invitation, will be lost forever. Jesus puts it like this: on that night, two people will be in one bed. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding grain together. One will be taken, the other left. Just as the tsunami took one person and left another. It's a somber message this morning. It's a warning. But it's a warning that comes from love, the love of God, the love of the Lord Jesus for sinners like you and me. Jesus longs for us to come to him and take shelter under his wings in the fire that is to come. So for those of you listening who still haven't come to Jesus in repentance and in faith, let me remind you of those tourists in Thailand taking photos of the exposed seafloor as the ocean receded. You are in real danger, and you need to run to Jesus for safety as quickly as you can. You need to come to the only one who will rescue you, the only one who can rescue you, the Son of Man, who gave his life to save you from the coming judgment of God. And for all of us who do know Jesus and are trusting in him for salvation today, let me remind you of that man in India who didn't simply run to the hills when he saw the waters of the ocean receding. He didn't just save his own skin and think, I'm okay. He he ran around his village, spreading the alarm, warning everybody he could find, and persuading them, doing everything he could to urge them to leave what they were doing and to come with him to the safe high ground in order that they might be saved. As Christian people, we need to stop just keeping the gospel to ourselves. We need to work harder to invite other people to join us, in the safety under the wings of the Lord Jesus, in the safety of the church, in the kingdom of God. So let's sing together our next hymn, which is called Facing a Task Unfinished, that drives us to our knees in prayer.
No other name has power.
Let's pray together. As we journey into the future and follow the path taken by Jesus, we know that we are not alone. We journey in the way of the cross and in the hope of the resurrection. God of hope, be with us as we journey into the future that lies before us. Be with us through your Son, who has journeyed in the way of the cross. Grant to us grace and faith that we might follow him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of hope, be with us as we journey into the future that lies before us. In all we face, be near to us and all whom we love, and guard us and keep us safe in your presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of hope, be with us as we journey into the future that lies before us. Be with those who fear this day and who struggle to see the future. Lead us from the darkness into your light. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of hope, be with us as we journey into the future that lies before us. Be with those who grieve this day and who feel bereft of comfort. In your compassion, be near to them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of hope, be with us as we journey into the future that lies before us. In all that is faced by our society today, grant wisdom, insight, and understanding, and especially to those who are called to govern our nation and to act on our behalf. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of hope, be with us as we journey into the future that lies before us. Be with us through your Son, whose journey in the way of the cross yields the hope of the resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
Strong deliver, strong deliver me.
To love and to serve the Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you now and forevermore. Amen.
My soul from death, my feet from stumbling, I